Yeah, so we are looking now on analytic proof for Wigner semicircle law. So first we should develop a bit the analytic tools and also notions of convergence, which we are going to use. So last time I introduced the Stieltjes transform, which is our analytic, let's say, analytic version of the moments. If we put the moments into a generating power series about infinity, it's more or less a, yeah, it's a formal power series, but we can extend it to all of the upper half plane, which is then the Stieltjes transform, which has nice analytic properties, and for which we in particular have the Stieltjes inversion formula, which allows to recover the measure really as a density, usually, if we know the Stieltjes transform close to the real axis. And so last time we derived from the recurrence formula of the Catalan numbers, which are the moments of the semicircle. We derived the Stieltjes transform. And I want to close this with the remark that this actually is a way of finding explicitly the semicircle if we know only its moments. Also, what we did last time, well, this was proposition 4.6. This gave us the Stieltjes transform of the semicircle just from the knowledge of the moments. And I mean, that's actually what we get if we do our combinatorial proof of Wigner semicircle law. Then we calculate the limit of the traces of powers and we get some moments. And okay, a priori, we don't know which distribution this is. But from what we did last time, we can use this for calculating the Stieltjes transform. And so what we got last time was that the Stieltjes transform S of z was given by minus z plus z squared minus 4 square root divided by 2. And I mean, in principle, this is the, yeah, this is the moment generating series in 1 over z of the Catalan numbers, but now extended to an analytic function all of the upper half plane. And then from this, we can really get now the semicircle density by invoking this Stieltjes inversion formula. So from this, we can then get the density of the semicircle via this Stieltjes inversion formula, Stieltjes inversion formula. So let us do this explicitly just to see how this works. So what do I have to do for the Stieltjes inversion formula? I have to take the Stieltjes transform close to the real axis and look on the imaginary part. And also normalize it by 1 over pi. Then the imaginary part of the Stieltjes transform. So if I want somehow to measure at the point x, I should go a little bit into the upper half plane. Then the Stieltjes transform is defined. So it's a complex number. I take the imaginary part. And if I send epsilon to 0, this converges to my measure. Okay, and if the measure has a density, then actually this will really converge to the density. So let us do this for this concrete situation. So I have here 1 over pi. I get a 2 from here. So I have 1 over 2 pi. And then the imaginary part of this thing here yeah, okay, so let me write it like this. So z is minus, z is x plus I epsilon, x plus I epsilon plus x plus I epsilon squared minus 4 the square root. Good. Okay, now I should send epsilon to 0. So of course the imaginary part of this guy is just the I epsilon. If epsilon goes to zero, this disappears. So this guy disappears, and I only get possibly an imaginary part from here. So what I get here, if I send epsilon to zero, I only get the imaginary part. And I mean, this guy here goes just to x squared minus 4. And of course, the square root interpreted in the right way as the square root in the complex plane. So what I get here is the imaginary part of x squared minus 4. Okay, and of course, the square root here, so if x is bigger than 2, then this here is a positive number, then the square root of this is just a real number which has no imaginary part. So I can only get an imaginary part if the thing under the square root is negative, which means x must be between minus 2 and plus 2. So this here, okay, so maybe this guy here, so this is nothing if x is absolute value if x is bigger than 2. And otherwise, I mean, if I have here a negative guy, then the imaginary part is just the square root minus this thing. So I get then 4 minus x squared square root if x is less than 2. Okay, and so this means the whole thing here converges exactly to the density of the semicircle. Together with this 1 over 2 pi, I get this density between minus 2 and plus 2 and 0 outside. So in particular, you see that from this you also get the fact that the semicircle is located on minus 2 to plus 2. So the whole thing here converges if epsilon goes to 0 to the function or the density 1 over 2 pi 4 minus x squared on the interval from minus 2 to plus 2, which is the density of the semicircle. So this shows that we can calculate the semicircle from the knowledge of the moments without having to know a priori the density. I mean, before we started from the semicircle and then I told you calculate the moments, that you see you get the Catalan numbers. But here we can also go the other way. So thus, this analytic machinery gives an effective way to calculate a distribution from the knowledge of its moments. A distribution from its moments without having to know the distribution or the density in advance, without having to know the density in advance. Okay, so having analytic tools, the complex analysis really means we can go from infinity, where we have the moments, close to the real axis, and there we have really this inversion formula which gives us a density. Good, okay, so this was about the Stieltjes transform. And now we really should look on the question of convergence, because what we really want to do is to prove a kind of convergence of probability measures to the semicircle. So we should talk a bit what we really mean with convergence of probability measures. So let us think a little bit about this. So now we want to consider convergence of probability measures mu n to mu. And I mean, this is the semicircle in our case, and this will be the eigenvalue distribution or the averaged eigenvalue distribution of our matrices. Those are really probability measures on R. And so what do I really mean with this? Or what are possibilities, what I could mean with this? So we can, and for this, I mean, one can, there are essentially two points of view on measures or probability measures. So namely, we can consider, let's say, measures or probability measures, finite measures, from two perspectives. And of course, this is equivalent, but it gives things a little bit a different touch. So from two equivalent perspectives. And the first one is the measure theory perspective. I mean measure theory. I mean, what is a measure? A measure tells us what is the size of sets. Huh? So we have the measures of sets. Huh? So if I have a measure, we can say this means we know the size of all our measurable sets. So mu gives us the measure. And if I have a probability measure, then we are interpreting this as giving us the probability of sets. So this gives us the measure. Or for probability measures, just the probability of sets. Huh? So this means what we know is mu of b for all, let's say, I don't know, in principle for all measurable sets on R. Or maybe you can also say, I mean, the measurable sets are generated by the intervals. So in principle, I know the measures of all the intervals. Huh? Or just mu of intervals of R. Okay, but then there's a more functional analytic perspective of this. So namely, usual thing you do if you have a measure, this allows you to integrate functions. So actually, a measure is also a mapping on functions. And this is more the functional analytic perspective. So if I have a measure, this allows us to integrate functions, and in particular, continuous functions. Continuous functions. Huh? So what we have from this point of view is that we know the integrals over all continuous functions with respect to our measure. So for continuous f. Okay, and I mean those two points of view are more or less equivalent. Huh? So here I have really a measure in a measure theoretic sense. Here I have essentially the mapping which sends a continuous function to its integral. Huh? So it's a linear form, a linear functional on continuous functions. Huh? And by Ries representation theorem, we know that these are equivalent. Huh? So even if you start from this, you can recover the measure. Good, okay, but having those two points of view suggests somehow two possibilities for what we could mean with a convergence of measures. So according to this, there are two canonical choices for notions of convergence. Of measures. Huh? So I mean the first frame, I mean we say a measure is given by knowing the measure of all the sets. So if you have convergence of measures, then we would expect that all those measures of sets converge. Huh? So we would ask that mu n of b converges to mu of b. Maybe we could ask for all measurable sets, but this would be maybe too much, or maybe we could just ask this for intervals, or maybe just for all intervals b. So this means if I have a probability measure, then I would say that the probability of some event converges, that the probabilities of events converges to some limiting object. In a second approach, of course, I would assume that all those integrals for continuous functions converge. Because there somehow the basic information is for each f, I can integrate it with respect to all my probability measures, and then I would ask that all those integrals converge to the corresponding integral with respect to the limit measure. So for all continuous f. Okay, and so what? Okay, it could be that both things are the same. Maybe, I mean, here they are essentially the same. But here one has to be a little bit careful because part one, if I'm asking, okay, if I'm asking it for all measures, this is much too much. But even if I'm just asking it for intervals, I might have problems. Huh? So in a sense, one is too rigid. So one is problematic. I mean, one might be the first thing you would suggest if you're talking about the convergence of probability measures. What would it mean? It should mean that all the probabilities of events should converge. But this is maybe a too strong requirement. So this is problematic in this generality. And the main problem is that somehow if I have atoms in my measures, it doesn't really take, it asks too much of the atoms. So it's as it does treat atoms of our mu too restrictive. It asks too much for them to converge. Oh, and maybe just a basic example which shows the problem. So namely, if we have measures which have atoms, and the atoms of the mu n converge to the atoms of the mu, then surely this should be a kind of, should satisfy our requirements for convergence. But if the atoms are sitting at different positions, then asking that the measures of sets converge is too much in this case. So let me take as an example just probability measures which have only one atom, but the position of the atom is changing with n. Well, so namely here is the example. So let's take as mu n, I take an atom which has only a mass 1 at one point, and the point is 1 minus 1 over n. Okay, so the position of the atom is at 1 minus 1 over n, so if n goes to infinity, of course I should get in the limit a measure which has an atom at position 1. So the situation is that I have, let's say, 0, 1, 1 half, 2 third, 3 over 4, and so on. So I have mu 0, mu 1 has an atom here, mu 2 is just a delta peak at 1 half, mu 2, then I have mu 3, mu 4, and so on. So I mean, I have, so each measure is just one atom, but the atoms are converging to 1, and so the limiting object should, of course, be mu, which has an atom at 1. But if I'm calculating probabilities of sets, then you see that they don't converge. So in this case, we surely want, at least I surely want, that this mu n converges to the mu. But if I take maybe an innocent interval, namely the interval, the closed interval from 1 to 2, and I calculate its probability, then you see that the atoms of all my mu n's are not inside this interval, but the limiting atom is, which means the mu n of this set are all 0, but the mu of this set is 1. And of course, the zeros don't converge to 1. So we have that mu n of this interval from 1 to 2 is 0, because the atom is outside of the interval. I mean, it's very close to the edge here, but it's not inside. And in a limit case, it's just inside. It's at 1. So mu of 1, 2 is equal to 1. So this means, I mean, if I want to require that all probabilities mu n of some sets converge to mu of this set, then this is too much, because it wouldn't cover this basic example. And I mean, this is really an example where I would like to have convergence. And so that's the reason that maybe 2 is the better definition. I mean, one can take 1, but one has to make some requirements. So you see the problem here is the boundaries of the sets B. So, and the problem is that I have mass in a limit at the boundary. If I exclude such things, then one can still make sense out of 1, but in a sense it's cleaner to use 2. So that's really will be the definition which we are going to use. So 2 is the better definition. But also there one has to be a little bit careful, because there I said, okay, I want this convergence for all continuous functions. And continuous functions can also be powers or so, functions which explode at infinity, and this is something which I should avoid. So what I really need in any case are bounded functions, because otherwise the integrals might not exist. So I want to have a class of functions for which I'm sure that such integrals make sense. And if I take continuous and bounded functions, then this integral is always defined. So we have to be careful. In this part 2, in our definition, which I'm going to make soon, but I have to think a little bit about what do I want to take all continuous functions, or maybe with some special conditions. So we have to be a little bit careful about which class of continuous functions we allow. Okay, so in any case, as I just said, we need bounded ones, bounded continuous functions, because otherwise this integral might not be defined, at least not for any probability measure, might not exist. In general. Okay, so this means taking bounded continuous functions might be a good idea, but it turns out, okay, this is a possible definition, but it turns out that another good idea would be to control functions even more at infinity, namely to take functions which go to 0 at infinity. And this has some compactness reasons, about which I will talk more in the following. So this here is a possible definition, but for compactness reasons, it is sometimes better to ignore, let's say, the behavior of the measures at infinity. To ignore the behavior of the measures at infinity, with which I mean plus minus infinity. And ignoring it means that I only take here functions which vanish at infinity, because they don't really see much about the mass at infinity. Okay, and according to this, I can take either bounded continuous functions or continuous functions which vanish at infinity. And this a priori are two different notions of convergence for measures, and I'm going to define them now. So, I mean, one of them is called awake convergence, and the other is called weak convergence. And so we have to understand this a little bit. Yeah, so let me maybe first introduce notations for the continuous functions, which we consider here. And there are essentially two sets, the bounded continuous functions and continuous functions which vanish at infinity. And of course, they are then necessarily bounded. So they are a subset of the bounded continuous functions. Yeah, so here's our definition. But first, let's do the notations for the relevant classes of continuous functions. So we use the notations. So maybe first one is, so C of R, of course, are just the continuous functions on R. But if I'm writing a zero here, C0 of R, those are by definitions the continuous functions which vanish at infinity. And of course, I have two infinities, plus minus, so I want that the limit of f of t, if t goes to plus or minus infinity, so the absolute value goes to infinity, that this is zero. Those are functions which go to zero at infinity. So those are continuous functions on R, and we say they vanish at infinity. So vanishing at plus minus infinity. Okay, and the other class, a bigger class, is the bounded ones, which I denote by CR, and then I'm putting a B here for bounded. So those are the continuous functions on R, which are bounded. So this means there is a bound, an m positive number, such that the absolute value, so my functions are, let's say, complex valued. Can also be real valued, but usually we have complex valued. So f of the absolute value is less than m for all t in R. Okay, so those are two nice classes, which we will consider. Of course, you could say we take all continuous functions, but then we have the problem that they might explode at infinity, and then we cannot assure that our integrals make sense. So those here are just the continuous bounded functions. Okay, and with this, we can now define the notions of convergence, which we're interested in. So this is part two. That's the real part of the definition. This was just notation. So there we take measure mu and a sequence mu n of. Okay, I mean, in the end, we are only interested in probability measures, but for a better understanding of all this, it's good to really do this on the level of finite measures. So all those guys should be finite measures on R. I mean, all this can be extended to arbitrary spaces, but we just do it on R, because then maybe some things are a little bit simpler. But the ideas and results are more or less the same. Okay, so then we say, that the sequence mu n converges, and now we make precise what we mean with this by saying vaguely, in a vague sense, or in a vague topology, to mu, if, or maybe first let me give it a notation denoted by, so I'm writing mu n converges to mu with this arrow, but I put a V over the arrow to indicate that now I really mean exactly this kind of convergence here. So if we have the convergence of the integrals for any function f in the class C0, so I'm requiring that f of t d mu n of t, the integral over f with respect to d mu n, converges if n goes to infinity to f of t d mu t. And this, of course, now is convergence of complex numbers. I mean, this integral is just a complex number. So this is just a sequence of complex numbers in n, and I'm requiring that this converges to these complex numbers. And I do this for any f which is a continuous function, but vanishing at infinity. So I have a quite strict condition on the f. And if I only take here bounded continuous functions, then I have the same, and I call it weak convergence. So the second part, so mu n converges weakly, or in weak topology, to mu, and I denote this similarly, just by putting a w on this arrow. So I say mu n goes to mu with this w. Or maybe in a probability context, very often you have also the double arrow. Maybe I think you also denote it like this, like implication arrow. Okay, but I'm not going to use this. So I'm using this. But in the probability theory, people are using this quite often. So I denote it by this. Yeah, if I have the same, but for a bigger class of functions. So weak convergence is stronger than wake convergence. So because I'm asking more. So I have f of t, d mu n of t converges to the integral f of t, d mu t, but now for all continuous and bounded functions. Good, so that's our definitions. And of course now one should think a little bit about what does it really mean in particular, what is the difference between the two? So is it really useful, I mean, to have those two? So let me make a few remarks about this. And the first remark is that weak convergence actually guarantees that if I'm starting from probability measures, that I have to converge again to a probability measure. Weak convergence doesn't guarantee this. And that's the reason that I'm not just making the definition for probability measures. Because even if all my mu n's are probability measures, at least in this case, I must allow the mu just to be a finite measure. And that's more or less the difference between the two. So namely, the weak convergence somehow has as part of its definition that I cannot lose mass in the limit, whereas wake convergence is allowed to do this. So yeah. So here's this remark. So note that weak convergence includes in particular the following. So namely, I mean, how do I see the mass of the whole mass of my measure? I see this by integrating over the constant function 1. Okay, and in weak convergence, I'm allowed to integrate over all bounded functions, and one is a bounded function. But it's not a function which vanishes at infinity. Okay, so for the weak convergence, I have in particular this kind of convergence, also if I take f to be the constant function 1 on all of R. So I have in particular that mu n of R, so the total mass of my measure, which I can write as the integral over the constant function 1 with respect to my measure. This has to converge to the corresponding integral for the limiting measure, but of course this integral is not just the mass with respect to mu. Okay, and so this means if I'm starting with probability measures, so if all the mu n's are probability measures, then all those guys are 1, and if I have weak convergence, then also this guy must be 1. So this means the weak limit thus the weak limit of probability measures must again be a probability measure. Okay, for the weight convergence, this is not true. I mean, at least, okay, this, it's not, I'm not seeing it directly from there, but I mean, we can also look on a counterexample which shows us that we have, can have weight convergence of probability measures to something which is not a probability measure. Not a probability measure. So for the weight convergence, this is not true, and in particular what can happen is that mass disappears at infinity. So the weight convergence doesn't really control what happens at infinity. So I can have probability measures, and I mean they are losing somehow mass to infinity. In the limit you don't see this mass anymore, but maybe still something remains. So this is not true, because there we can lose mass at infinity. And here's a simple example which shows that this really can happen. Again, I'm just taking very easy discrete measures, so mu n. Let's say this is 1/2 delta 1, so plus 1/2 delta n. So this has two atoms, one at 1 and one at n, and it puts mass 1/2 here at the point 1 and one mass 1/2 at the point n. But of course, if n goes to infinity, then this point here, this will move to infinity. And somehow it will disappear. But so maybe let us see precisely what happens. So if we want to see that this guy converges to something in a weak topology, I mean it cannot converge in the okay, let us first check the weak topology. So if you want to see that it converges weakly, we have to check what happens with integrals of functions f with respect to this measure. So let us look on f of t d mu n of t. So what is this? So this is atoms at 1 and at n. So what I'm getting here is the value of my function f at the point 1 with the weight 1/2 and the value of the function f at the point n with weight 1/2. So this is 1/2 f of 1 plus 1/2 f of n. Yeah, but now if n goes to infinity and I'm looking in a weak convergence, so this means f is a function which vanishes at infinity, then this f of n goes to 0. So this guy here goes to 0 for the functions which vanish at infinity. So this means this whole integral here converges just to this term. This is fixed. This doesn't depend on n. So this is 1/2 f of 1, which of course I can again write as an integral with respect to a measure, and the measure of course is just this here. But this is now, so this is the integral over f of t d mu t, where now this mu is just this term here, 1/2 f of 1, delta 1. So it's this part here. Yeah, and so you see, I mean, what we see from this, for all continuous functions vanishing at infinity, we have that this guy here converges to this, which means that those measures here converge in a weak topology to this mu. So this means that the sequence of measures, 1/2 delta 1 plus 1/2 delta n, converges weakly to 1/2 of delta 1. And here, of course, those guys are always probability measures. They always have total mass 1. These are probability measures for all n. But the limit object, of course, is not a probability measure. It's a finite measure, but the total mass is only 1/2. Because the other half, which we always had here, this got lost at infinity. We don't see it anymore in the limit. So this here is just a finite measure. With total mass 1/2. Yeah, good. Okay, but you might say, okay, this might be nice. So in general, if I'm interested in finite measures, wake convergence might be a more general concept. But from our point of view, what we really want to do is essentially to prove the convergence of probability measures to a probability measure. And so the question is why would then wake convergence be interesting for us? And the reason is that very often, if we have a sequence of probability measures and we want to show that they converge, a priori we might not know that they converge, and we don't really know is there a limiting object. In particular, is there a probability measure as a limiting object? And in such contexts, it's usually important to have compactness arguments, which ensure you that at least you have a convergence of a subsequence. So if you have an arbitrary sequence and you want to check does it converge and you don't know much about it, then you need something you can work with. And usually the something is given by compactness arguments, which says you at least by compactness reasons we know that a subsequence converges. And then we have something which converges and we can work with this and maybe derive properties of this. Okay, and that's what one also needs. And the point is that we have compactness in this context, but only in a wake convergence. And so that is the reason that it's good to consider also wake convergence here and then use these compactness arguments for the concrete problem. And then maybe at the end you see that actually we converge to something which is a probability measure. But maybe we don't know this from the beginning. But we have something concrete to work with. Good, so maybe we write this down as the second point of the remark here. And then I will tell you the concrete property of compactness which we have here. Of course, maybe one should have in mind, what is actually our goal? We have this notion of convergence, and in the end, of course, we want to describe this notion of convergence with our Stieltjes transforms. That's the point of our analytic approach, that we have analytic nice functions, the Stieltjes transforms, and we want to treat with them the convergence. So what I'm after in the end is really that the convergence which we want, weak or wake, actually is equivalent to the pointwise convergence of the Cauchy transforms. And now I just want to give you the reason why this is the case. So and for this one has to understand a little bit about these properties of the wake and the weak convergence. So the second part is, the first part was more or less saying that in the end it's really the weak convergence which probably is the interesting for us. So why am I talking here about wake convergence? So the relevance of the wake convergence even if we are only interested in probability measures, only interested in probability measures, is that probability measures are actually showing a kind of compactness in the wake topology, but not in the weak topology. So I just try to convince you that it is good to have some compactness arguments. So is that the probability measures are compact, or maybe pre-compact is maybe the right word here. So pre-compact in the wake topology. But not in the weak topology. So what does it mean? What compactness means what? Compactness means whenever I have a sequence, I find a convergent subsequence. And of course, in this case here, I don't find a convergent subsequence of mu n which converges in the weak topology. If it would converge in a weak topology, it also would converge here. And the limit object has losing the mass. So in a weak topology, it must converge to a probability measure, but it doesn't. So the whole sequence converges to something which has lost mass, so any subsequence will do the same. So in the above example, where our sequence was given by 1/2 delta 0 plus 1/2 delta n, this has no subsequence. Which converges weakly. But of course, it has a subsequence which converges weakly because the whole sequence already converges. But it has a subsequence, namely itself, so the whole sequence, which converges weakly. So this shows that, for the weak convergence, I cannot expect that I have compactness, which means, which is bad for general purpose proofs. But it turns out that in the wake topology, I have this. And so maybe this is the main basic theorem about this, which I want to write down. And then I want to give you some idea of the proof for this, or how this fits into more general context. So here's the basic theorem on this. So it says that the space of probability measures on R, but this is true more general, so this is actually a pre-compact in the wake topology, not in the weak one topology. And so what does this say? What do I mean with this? It's here about sequential compactness. So this says that every sequence mu n, n indexed by the natural numbers, so any sequence of probability measures does not necessarily have to converge in a wake topology, but there exists always a subsequence which converges. So probability measures on R has a subsequence which converges weakly to a limit, and this limit in a weak topology doesn't necessarily have to be a probability measure. Huh? So I can only assure that it converges in a vague topology to a finite measure. And this limit might have lost mass, so I can also, it's also quite clear that the total mass of this limit object has mass less or equal 1 with mu of r less or equal than 1. So I might lose mass by doing this. Okay. And of course, if I want to check really the convergence of probability measures to a probability measure, I mean, then of course I can use this, and in the end I should then see whether the total mass is 1 or not. So somehow I should separate what happens with the mass at infinity from all the rest. Good, so this is a basic theorem, and actually, yeah, this theorem is a basic theorem from the two points of view which I gave you above about what is a probability measure or what is a measure. I mean, a measure is on one side really a measure in the measure theoretic sense, and on the other side it's really a function, a linear function, linear functional on continuous functions. And in the same way, you have two kinds of proof of this, whether you're coming from functional analysis or whether you're coming more from probability theory. And so maybe I want to put this maybe in a context. And so first of all, from the functional analytic perspective, from a functional analytic perspective, this actually is a special case of a famous theorem, is Banach-Alaoglu. So this is a special case. Of a theorem which is named after Banach and Alaoglu. Theorem. And this is essentially about the dual space of Banach spaces. And actually measures are the dual space. Namely saying that if I have a measure, I can integrate continuous functions. This essentially says that measures are the dual space of the set of continuous functions, and it's really the C0 space. So S, and I mean I should allow here complex measures. So S complex measures on R, they are the dual space, the set of continuous linear functionals. If you don't know about functional analysis, you can just ignore what I'm saying here, but just if you know, I mean, this puts it into perspective. So it's a dual space of the Banach space, C0, exactly the space which we used for defining the vague topology. So the space of continuous functions which vanish at infinity with the uniform norm is a nice Banach space. One of the basic classical Banach spaces. And the dual space of this are exactly complex measures. This is more or less this Ries representation theorem, which makes this connection between the measure theoretic approach and the functional analytic approach. So are the dual space of the Banach space C0 of R, and actually the vague topology which I defined above is really the topology on this dual space. So the weak star topology on this, which is a canonical topology on this functional analytic object. So, and it's weak star topology is exactly the vague topology. So this means from a functional analytic point of view, the vague topology is exactly the right thing. And then, I mean, there is this Banach-Alaoglu theorem which says that the dual space of a Banach space is compact in its weak star topology. And essentially, I mean, in the end, this goes back maybe to a theorem in topology, which is Tychonoff, which is about a product of compact spaces is again compact in the right topology. So in principle, those, these are all those things. Good, but on the other hand, I mean, people who are doing measure theory or probability theory don't care so much often about functional analysis. So I mean, this whole theorem is also known in this community, but there it goes under a totally different name. There it is called Halley's theorem or Halley's selection theorem. And of course, you can also give a direct proof, and that's what is usually done. So you can ignore this functional analytic perspective. And if you're coming from more measure theory, or if you're looking into books about measure theory or probability theory, then this usually goes under the name of Halley's selection theorem. So from a measure theory perspective, this is known as Halley's theorem, or maybe selection, because you're selecting a subsequence, Halley's selection theorem. Okay, and maybe I give you the ideas of the proof for this, because maybe, yeah, I mean, also, it shows you maybe what this is all about. So here are the main ideas. It also gives you some more ideas about this wake or this kind of convergence here. So here are the main ideas for the proof. Okay, so first of all, we would like, so if I'm given a sequence of measures, I want to select somehow a subsequence. Okay, and for this, it's good to again go over to more the measure theoretic point of view and really describe my measure by a function, namely by its distribution function. And this is in particular nice on R. So really I can encode the information about a measure in the measure of intervals. Or it's even enough to take the interval from minus infinity up to some point. So if I'm integrating, let's say, or I'm taking the measure of the interval from minus infinity to some point, and this point is t, then I have a function depending on t, and this is what is called a distribution function. Of course, it's a distribution, also of random variables and so on, but so it's good to describe measures by such an object, and I can do this for any finite measure. Let's say, so we describe a finite measure mu by its distribution function, which I call f mu, and this is a function from R to R, so it's given by f mu is a function from R to R, which is defined just by so f mu at a point t. So what is this? This is nothing else than the measure of the interval from minus infinity up to the point t. And here I take the closed, so t is included. Okay, so this contains all information about my measure. So if you want to recover the measure, that's enough. Because if I know this, then I know it for all intervals. And a measure is determined by the knowledge of the measure on the interval. Good. But here we can be much more precise. Namely, we can say the functions f, which I get here, the distribution functions, is a class of functions which I can describe very nicely. So namely, what is this function? What are the properties? Of course, if I go to minus infinity, it will be zero. If I go to plus one, I will get the whole mass. In between, it's a function which is monotone increasing, or it's not decreasing. And then, of course, it might have jumps. Namely, if I have atoms in my measure, then it might have jumps, but actually it is continuous on the right. So it has some kind of continuity, which of course depends whether I put the closed interval here or not. And with this, it's continuous on the right. And the other way around, any function which has those properties arises as the distribution function of a measure. So I can describe measures also by distribution functions. And this means then I can also hope to translate the convergence, my weak or wake convergence, into convergence of the distribution functions. And this can be done. And then I'm more or less back to the original idea of describing the convergence of measures by saying what happens with the measure of intervals. And we saw there are problems if we have atoms at the boundary, but this is the only problem. So actually, we can describe our convergence also in terms of this. Yeah, okay, so distribution functions can be described exactly as functions with the properties which I just mentioned. So such distribution functions are exactly functions f with the properties that it's a non-decreasing function. So it's really a function from R to R. So t goes to f of t is non-decreasing, because then I'm taking measures of increasing sequence of intervals. If I go to minus infinity, and such functions have a limit going to minus infinity and going to plus infinity. And at minus infinity, this limit should be zero. And at plus infinity, this should be finite. Of course, it will be the total mass of my measure at this point. And then it has some kind of continuity properties. So namely, f is continuous on the right. Not necessarily on the left, because if I have jumps, if I have atoms in my measure, this corresponds to jumps in this function. Yeah, okay, so I can encode in a one-by-one way a measure by its distribution function, and I can also encode the wake convergence in terms of these distribution functions. So the wake convergence of mu n converges to mu in the wake topology can also be described in terms of the distribution functions. Terms of their distribution functions. Say fn is the function for mu n and f is the function for mu, then mu n converges to mu in a wake topology is equivalent that we have fn of t converges to f of t. So this is the measure of the interval from minus infinity to t converges to the measure from minus infinity of t of mu. But as we saw before, atoms might be problematic. And so the problem was if the atom, actually in a limit, is sitting on the boundary of the interval. Which means I cannot require this if this f of t is not continuous at t. But otherwise, this is okay. So I'm requiring this here, not actually for all t, but only for those at which f is continuous. And then it's okay. And of course, there can be only countably many points of discontinuities of f. So at most points, I really require this. Good, so I can now also encode the wake convergence in a distribution function, and now we just try to find a subsequence for those distribution functions, because this is now an object, this is a collection of functions, and it's easier to deal with this. Measures are always complicated objects. If you want to do something with measures, somehow it's usually you describe it in terms of functions, and then you do the things for the functions, and then you go back. So now we have to find the subsequence. So let us see. So we start with a sequence mu n, and let's say we take now probability measures. In this case, of course, the f of infinity is 1, f of plus infinity is 1. So we take such probability measures. And then we go over to the distribution functions. So we take the corresponding, distribution functions, let me call them fn. So it's a sequence of functions which satisfies those properties. And what I'm claiming now is that I can find a subsequence of those guys which converge in this sense. And we want to find convergent subsequence for those. And convergent in this sense for the distribution functions. Okay, and so what do we do with this? So if I have a function, and I want to show that the function converges. Okay, and then if I don't know much about the function, so I usually go back to looking on the value of the function at points and want to see that at least it converges at as many points as possible. And if I know, for example, that my function is bounded or so, then I know that I find convergent subsequences. But of course, I should do this as many points as possible. And compactness arguments allows me to deal with countably many points. So what I can ensure is countably many points. And of course, with them I want to cover R, so I should choose a dense subset of R of points, and then at least try whether I can ensure that at those points they converge. And because then I have functions which have some properties, this will ensure that actually it converges everywhere in this sense. So I'm starting now. So for this, we choose a countable but dense subset. So a countable set which is dense in R, subset of R. And let me call this set T. It's countable, so I can number the points T1, T2, and so on. So I have a countable subset of R. Let's take all rational numbers, which I can order. And then, what I'm going to do now is that I'm choosing subsequences, ensuring that at least at a point T1 I get convergence. Of this, I choose another subsequence such that at least at point 2 I get convergence, and so on. Which means I can arrange that at finitely many points I get convergence. And then one uses this diagonal idea that I take the diagonal subsequence, which ensures then that I really get convergence at all those countably many points. So maybe let me write this down a little bit more concretely. But this is the typical, the crucial part of the proof of Banach Alaoglu or Tichonov, that you do this diagonal argument, that you ensure somehow that you have convergence at a dense set. And getting convergence at finite many points is easy, but then going over to this countable one is essentially this Cantor's diagonal idea. taking the diagonal subsequence. Okay, so let me say a few more words about this. And then, of course, there are a couple of things which one has to check, which, of course, I'm not going to do, but I just want to give you the basic idea what is going on and how you really prove such things. I mean, if you have seen those things before, it should be standard, but, I mean, maybe it's not bad to even repeat standard things which are nice, because these are really basic, basic ideas. Okay, so what we do, so we have this sequence of the Fs, and now we are choosing a subsequence where we are looking on just on the value of the Fs at one point, at the point T1. Okay, and because the Fs are somehow bounded, because I have probability measures, the Fs are always smaller than 1. I have a uniform bound on all of them, which means at each point the values are always between 0 and 1. So I have a sequence of real numbers between 0 and 1, and then because of the compactness of such intervals, or Bolzano-Weierstrass, or whatever this is, I know at least I find a subsequence which converges there. So this tells me that I find a subsequence of my original sequence. Let's say I'm taking n1 of m, so I'm running now over m, and with this I'm taking a subsequence of the natural numbers, such that this subsequence at least converges at the point t1. I'm not caring about what it does at the other points, but at this one point it converges to something, and so I give a name to the limit. I call it f sub t of t1. Good. Okay, now I improve this by choosing now another subsequence of this guy. So choosing a subsequence of this means I'm not losing what I already know about t1, but I can now improve it at some other point. So I'm now looking on what happens at the point t2, and then again I can choose a subsequence which converges at this point t2. So choose then, I mean, a subsequence of this, not of the original sequence, but only of the sequence where I already know that it converges at t1. Of course, this is a subsequence of the original sequence. So I have now n2 of m. I'm just running over a subset of the numbers of this, such that now this sequence, I mean, because it's a subsequence of this, it still converges at the point t1. But in addition, it also converges at the point t2. Converges to something which I call now ft subscript of t1. Okay, and I continue in this way, and so I can, by always choosing subsequences of the previous subsequence, I can get, for any k, I can get a subsequence of my original sequence which converges at the first k points. So iterating this. Gives now a sequence of subsequences, so namely f indexed by nk of m, I'm running over m, such that this subsequence converges at all the points t1 up to tk. For any k in n, such that fnk of m at the point ti converges to something which I denote ft of ti, and this happens for all I between 1 and k. So I can ensure that it converges at the first k points. I can make k as big as I want, but of course if I make k bigger and bigger, the subsequence getting thinner and thinner, and there would be nothing left. Okay, so the point is now, how do I get actually a subsequence which converges now at all those uncountably many, discountably many, but infinitely many points. And this is the idea that I take somehow the diagonal subsequence of all those subsequences. So I have all my subsequences getting thinner and thinner, but I take somehow the diagonal sequence out of them. And this converges then at all those points. So the diagonal subsequence, where I'm taking actually from each of the subsequences one element, namely I take the kth element of the kth subsequence. So or let's say here I take n m, the mth element of the nth subsequence. And I'm looking on this. So this is now, this is still a subsequence of my original sequence, but at its tail, it agrees with all the, it has the same properties of as all of the subsequences. So this means this has the property that it actually converges at the infinitely many t's, which I have there. So this converges then at all t in t to my ft of t. Yeah, okay, so I have now at least a subsequence which converges at this dense subset. Okay, and of course now because my f's have all these kind of continuity properties, this is enough to ensure that actually it converges also at all the other points. But of course, it converges to this ft of t, and this ft of t might not be a priori a distribution function because it might not have the right form of continuity, this right continuity, and for this we are improving this. So namely, now we really take our limit object, which is f of t, and this is essentially taking this function but making it right continuous. Because this might not have this continuity, because I mean it depends on where we have chosen our dense subset. And we might have chosen points where we have maybe too many jumps, or the jumps of our subsequences or our sequences don't behave in the right way. Okay, but we can improve on this by taking here the infimum over the f t of s, where s is in t and s is bigger than t. And with this we are making this guy a right continuous, and then one really can see that now it is a distribution function and that actually my subsequences converge to this guy in the sense of convergence which we want. Of course, I mean there are some things which one has to check and I don't want to go into this. So one can show that this f is now a distribution function, which means it corresponds to measure and my subsequence nmm of t converges to this f of t, if m goes to infinity, at all points of continuity of this guy. At all points of continuity of f. And as I've said before, this really means that the corresponding subsequence of my probability measures mu n converge in a vague topology to the measure which corresponds to this guy. And that is really what I wanted to see. But we also see that here it is not guaranteed that this here corresponds to a probability measure, because we don't know that this at infinity, we know it's a increasing function, so it has to go something, but this something is bounded by one, but it can also be smaller. There's no argument here which would ensure that this corresponds to a probability measure. So it just corresponds to a measure. And that this means we get a convergent subsequence, but it's not guaranteed that this converges to a probability measure, but it only converges to a finite measure with total mass less or equal to one. So note that fn, so I mean all our guys are probability measures, so their limit at infinity is 1, for all n. And this allows us, of course, to get that f of plus infinity is less or equal than 1. But we cannot guarantee that it is equal to 1. So in general, it might be just a sub-probability measure. Good. Yeah, and this means we have compactness in the weak topology. And of course, we would like to have compactness in the weak topology because we really want convergence to a probability measure. And as we see from here, the problem is if we cannot control mass at infinity for our sequence, then we might lose mass. Okay, so if you want compactness in a weak topology, you should in addition be able to control what happens at infinity in a uniform way for all your elements in the sequence of your probability measures. And that's the notion of tightness which does this. So in probability theory, very often you have this notion of tightness, which is essentially telling you that you have a uniform control about what happens with the mass at infinity. And if you have a tight sequence, then it's enough to have also the compactness in the weak topology. Okay. So if we want compactness in the weak topology. So if we want, if you want an argument that if I'm given a sequence of probability measures that it really converges to a probability measure, then I need to know something more about my sequence of probability measures. Namely, we must control what happens at infinity. Then we must control the mass at infinity, and we must do this in a uniform way. In a uniform way. Okay, and there's this notion of tightness. So this is given by the notion of tightness. So namely, we say a sequence of probability measures, so sequence mu n, indexed by n, of probability measures, so this is tight, if for any epsilon I'm able to find an interval such that all my measures don't have mass more than epsilon outside. So I can control, there might be a little bit of mass always being close to infinity. For each measure, the bigger I make my interval, the less and less mass I have outside. But this might not be the same for all measures. And tightness tells me that I have a uniform control on this. So for all measures, I find intervals such that all measures have most of their mass inside this interval. So it's tight if for any epsilon bigger than 0, I find a compact interval, let's say from minus r to plus r, doesn't matter, just a compact interval, such that the mass outside of this interval is less than epsilon in a uniform way for all of my mu n's, such that the mass of the complement of this interval, so what is from minus infinity to minus r and from r to plus infinity, that this is less or less equal than epsilon, but for all n. So I find one interval which works for all n. So finding for each n such an interval, that's not a problem. But finding this in a uniform way, that's a condition. And then, if I have such a tight sequence, then actually this has a convergent subsequence. Then I have enough information which tells me that mass cannot, I have wake convergence to something, but with this tightness I can control that no mass is allowed to escape to infinity. And then I know that I have actually the wake convergence to a probability measure And the weight convergence to a probability measure is the same as the weak convergence. So then one has, so any tight sequence of probability measures has a subsequence which converges weakly. And of course, it must then necessarily converge weakly to a probability measure. Necessarily to a probability measure. Okay, and with this, one can then also relate the question of the weak convergence maybe to the notion of convergence which we considered up to now in our combinatorial approach, namely the question of convergence of moments. So what we proved in the combinatorial approach was looking on moments. Okay, but what we really want is weak convergence, and in some cases this is the same. So I mean, actually, if we know that we can show that all moments converge to the moments of the semicircle, this is actually the same as showing that I have weak convergence to the semicircle. But of course, this is not obvious. And I mean, this follows somehow from these considerations together with the fact that I have enough tightness if I know that the limit measure is determined by its moments. Okay, so I will talk more about this next time, but maybe just because on one of the assignments, I think, it's also about these questions of determined by the moment. So what does this mean? I will write it down next time in a precise way. But a probability measure is determined by its moments if, first of all, of course, it has all moments. But secondly, there is no other probability measure which has the same moments. So if I have another measure which has the same moments, then it must agree with this. Okay, and for example, the semicircle is determined by its moments. And then there will be a theorem which I talk about next time, that if I have a sequence and the question whether this converges to a limit object, if this limit object is determined by its moments, then the weak convergence is equivalent to the convergence of the moments, which means that what we were doing in a combinatorial approach is also showing the weak convergence. But for this, I want to explain this again a little bit more. And it might also be interesting to know that not every measure is determined by its moments. So there are really different probability measures. Each of them has all moments, and actually they have the same moments, but they are still not the same. Which means, of course, at infinity their behavior must be somehow different. Good, anyhow, so I will talk a little bit more about this next time. And then, of course, I should finally also come to maybe the most interesting thing for us, namely, how can we describe the weak convergence in terms of the Stieltjes transform? And of course, this was not just, I mean, these things here, of course, are interesting from a higher point of view to give you some idea, I mean, what we have here, but those things are also important for really proving this relation between weak convergence and the level of the Stieltjes transform. Good, okay, that's it for today.